Four things to know about ADHD. It is a neurodevelopmental disorder. It has three symptoms: attention deficit, hyperactivity, and impulsivity. There are quite a few controversies about it, and it is an eminently treatable condition. I am Carlos Hoyos. I am a child and adolescent psychiatrist and a psychiatry teacher. I have 20 years experience of treating ADHD. I am a senior lecturer in medical education in Winchester and a coordinator of psychiatry module in Southampton Medical School. I work for two NHS trusts and a private company. So what are these four things? Let's start with the neurodevelopmental disorder. This is essentially a disorder of the development of the nervous system or the brain. So the brain grows from in the fetus up until birth, and it becomes bigger and more complex. And that process continues after birth. In fact, most of the complexity and development of the brain happens after birth. The humans are one of the species that are born with the most immature brain, but the process catches up very quickly during the first 5 years of life. And that is when things might go wrong and we might end up with a disordered development of the brain. So what's this process by which a tiny immature brain becomes a mature healthy brain or a mature disordered brain? Well, we know that parents and education and all the process of nurture can make a difference as to the way a brain develops. And of course, we know that pre-existing genetic problems also have an influence on whether a brain develops normally or in a disordered way. This is a debate between genes and nurture, or between nature and nurture. It's a debate that I really don't want to go in today. I am more interested in the problematic of calling a type of development a disorder as opposed to normal development. And that takes us to understand how that process happens. So, because a brain might develop normally or abnormally, but it might develop in ways which are not statistically normal, but not necessarily disordered. And this takes us into the idea of neurological diversity. So the idea that a brain does not need to develop always in the same way, and that there is such thing as neurodiversity. And the advocates of this idea, of which I am one, would say that it's much better to describe development as typical and atypical rather than normal or disordered. So what makes a disordered development? What is the element that makes a brain not just normal or typical or atypical, but actually disordered? Well, that's an interesting question that ICD-10, which is the book that we use to classify mental illnesses, makes. So ICD-10 says the moment there is an impairment, then it can be considered disordered. And impairment is what differentiates what is normal, either typical or atypical, to what we can call a disorder. And ICD-10 defines impairment as difference that produces suffering or disability. So let's look at that in a bit more detail. So everything can be diverse, but the minute that diversity causes an impairment, i.e. a disability or undue suffering, then that becomes a disorder. So let's take a difference. For instance, some people's brains are mirrored, and left on most brains is right in those, and we call those left-handed. So left-handed brains are atypical, but are they disordered? Well, according to ICD-10, if that causes an impairment and a disability, then it is. So we could argue left-handed people struggle to write with their right hands, and they can't use scissors. Therefore, they have an impairment because it produces that difference, produces a disability. Of course, that's very controversial, and I think it's worth looking at it in a bit more detail. So impairment, it refers to a structural difference, and disability refers to functional difference. So impairment is means something is different, is different, or the structure is different. And disability means you can do things differently or you cannot do things. According to ICD-10, a difference is an impairment if it produces a disability. So let's take right and left-handed brains. So it will be an impairment if it causes a disability. So left-handed people have less skillful right hands. The fact that they have more skillful left hands doesn't come into this, because their right hands are not like most people, which means they can't use scissors, which means that it's a disability because it's something they can't do, and that produces a handicap. Handicap is another of those controversial concepts. Handicap is when, because of a disability, you're not able to perform a social role. So in this case, if you wanted to be a tailor, you wouldn't be able to become a tailor because all the scissors are right-handed scissors and they don't have any in the tailors. So you cannot be a tailor. So you have a handicap. You cannot be a tailor because you can't use scissors because your brain is different. So that's how we would think of left-handedness as being a disorder. Of course, we all know it's not just that simple, because left-handed people make tailors because there is such thing as left-handed scissors, which means that they are not handicapped, which means that they don't have a disability, which means that the difference is not an impairment, and therefore being left-handed is not a disorder, or not now that we have left-handed scissors. Let me give you another example, which is, I think, a bit more appropriate. Some people have difference in the structure of their eyes. Their curvature means that they are short-sighted. And of course, if you have those eyes that are short-sighted, you could argue it's diversity. We have diversity in eyes. Some eyes are good at focusing at all distances, and some of them are only good at focusing in front of your nose. So being short-sighted doesn't necessarily become an impairment. But actually, being short-sighted is an impairment, because kids who are short-sighted struggle to see the blackboard. And because they struggle to see the blackboard, they often have problems in school, unless they wear glasses. What glasses do is they allow for the impairment, but they stop the impairment becoming a disability, because they can see the blackboard with their glasses, and therefore they perform academically like everybody else. So you can see how the relationship between impairment, disability, and handicap is not quite straightforward, and we will revisit this difficulty in a minute. But that's what we need to know, to understand the difference between what a brain's development is a neurodiverse brain development, and which one is a disorder. And this is how we think of ADHD. We think of ADHD as a diverse development of the brain that produces impairment, disability, and handicap, or can produce them. And that's why we think of it as a neurodevelopmental disorder, not just a neurodevelopmental difference. So let's look at what this ADHD is, what the symptoms are. Now we're going into the second part of this lecture, which is looking in a bit more detail at those three symptoms. So attention deficit, hyperactivity, and impulsivity. Those need to be present before the age of 4, because as we saw, that's when the brain develops. And they need to be present across settings. That means the difficulties need to be present both in school and at home. And those are the criteria that ICD-10 ascribes to ADHD. Those are the 5 boxes, in a way, we need to tick. But often ADHD is associated with many other symptoms. For instance, when I talk about ADHD to teachers, they often talk about ADHD kids as being aggressive, and sometimes they are oppositional, and sometimes they become irritable very easy, or they have terrible tempers, or they are quite demanding beyond what you would expect from other kids, or they have sleep problems or sensory integration difficulties or specific learning difficulties. And those are symptoms that are often associated with neurodevelopmental disorders as well. So we know that those problems are associated with things going wrong in the way the brain develops. And sometimes they have other neurodevelopmental symptoms such as struggling to understand people or understand social communication or having very narrow interests and needing routines and things always the same, and they have problems communicating. Now, those three symptoms of neurodevelopmental disorders, we group together and we give it a specific name, autism, which is another neurodevelopmental disorder, which is often comorbid, and I'll talk about that in a minute later. But the important thing to know is that what diagnoses ADHD is attention deficit, hyperactivity, and impulsivity before the age of four and across settings. Two-thirds of kids who have that also have other symptoms of other neurodevelopmental disorders. But what makes the diagnosis is not maybe the presenting symptoms, which might be opposition, but the presence of those key symptoms. And if those key symptoms don't exist, that doesn't mean the kids don't have problems, because it might be that kids have a neurodevelopmental problem that includes symptoms like temper dysregulation and sleep problems and specific learning difficulties and oppositional behavior and some symptoms of ADHD and some symptoms of autism. In that case, often clinically is a problem because these kids are very disabled and very handicapped, but they don't meet the criteria for ADHD. ADHD is those three key symptoms, and I'm going to explain them in a bit more detail. So attention deficit, hyperactivity, and impulsivity. You have all three across settings before the age of four. In ICD-10, which is the manual used in the UK, that is an hyperkinetic syndrome. And that represents 1.5 to 3% of the population of children would meet the diagnosis. Not that we diagnose as many, but that is roughly what we estimate the proportion of children who would fulfill all those criteria. Now, in America, they use DSM-5, which is this diagnostic statistic manual, and that takes a slightly different approach to the symptoms. In DSM-5, there is a possibility of having just two of the three symptoms, for instance, attention deficit and impulsivity, and that has a name on itself. That's called attention deficit disorder, ADD. DSM-5 also allows for another combination of symptoms, which should be kids who have hyperactivity and impulsivity without attention deficit. And that has another name, which is hyperactivity disorder. And that's how DSM-5 defines ADHD as AD and or HD. And that's where the name ADHD comes from, is from DSM-5, not from ICD-10. But using that criteria, either two, including impulsivity, that catches about 3 to 6% of kids. It's worth mentioning that a lot of girls fulfill the criteria for ADD. So let's look at the symptoms one by one. Attention deficit. What do we mean by attention deficit? How do we understand what that means? Well, most people think of attention deficit as a problem with focusing. Yes. So the metaphor is that of a torch that has a variable focusing. So if you move the lens forward, you have focused. And we assume that is just what it looks like when we pay attention to something, as opposed to unfocused attention. And that the problem with attention deficit is that they're unable to focus their attention. They're unable to screen out things that are not important, as if there was something wrong in the mechanism that focuses the light. Yes. That rings a bell, but that is not how most people think about the deficit of attention nowadays. The metaphor I like best is the idea of aiming attention, as if you aim an arrow. The problem with the attention deficit is not that they cannot shoot arrows, is that they cannot hold the bow for long enough that the arrow hits the target. And their attention usually wanders from one thing to the other, and they struggle to keep attention in place. So the problem is not with the focusing mechanism. The problem is, if you want, with the wrist, the ability to hold the focus where they want it. So the problem is with holding attention, the holding attention mechanism, if you want. And we know that that's to do with motivation. So you hold attention when you're motivated to do so. And you're motivated to pay attention when you are anticipating a reward. And we do know that kids with ADHD, when they are anticipating a reward because the rewards come quickly, or when they are extremely motivated because they're very interesting, or because things are very exciting, they are able to hold attention. But that's the only time when they're able to hold attention. So that means that they cannot hold the attention, they appear distractible. But there are other symptoms associated with attention deficit because they can't hold things on. They also appear as forgetful because things don't go in, the things fall off their brains easily. And they also can become quite disorganized because they are unable to hold on to sequences or the way things should be done one after another because they can't hold them all at the same time. And therefore they avoid complicated things, and they very often fail to complete tasks. So they lose concentration and interest halfway through tasks, and they learn that they won't do it, so they avoid doing things that require concentration. And sometimes, particularly girls, might appear like in a daze. So that's what I'm going to say about attention deficit. The second symptom is hyperactivity. Hyperactivity is the second symptom that's in the name, and that is often equated to having unbound energy. So kids with ADHD are full of energy and they fidget all the time with their hands. They can't stand still and they can't stop moving. As a consequence, they're often loud and noisy. Everybody knows where they are. They're full of energy. That is something quite apparent, particularly in little children and particularly in boys. They're often referred to as they go off like a rocket. Yes. And the rocket metaphor is funny because it implies energy, but it's more accurate to describe this third symptom. Because the thing about rockets is they have no brakes. And that talks to the third symptom, which is impulsivity, which is what happens when you are unable to stop yourself, which is what impulsivity is. So in impulsivity, something pops into their heads and they're off. They cannot stop themselves. And that's one of problems in ADHD. As a consequence, kids who are impulsive will often interrupt you because they can't wait. Yes, and often will get up from the chair in the class and walk around, and they struggle to wait their turns. And that's evident in the classroom, but also when they play games or with their friends. Impulsivity, which is a key symptom, which in DSM-5 is needed for both attention deficit and hyperactivity disorder. So this is the third of the three key symptoms that we've covered. And that takes us to the third bit, which I said I would mention, which is that things are a bit controversial. And looking at those symptoms, that's how controversy starts, because it is quite a rich thing to say that kids who struggle to pay attention, who are full of energy and who are impulsive, have a disorder. These are three symptoms or three ways of being that a lot of kids have. And it's very difficult to tick the box for all those three, or everybody tricks the box for all of three. You don't find kids who are not like that at some time. The first bit about the controversy is to understand that although we talk about those three symptoms as symptoms, what they are is variations of normality. And what makes those variations into a symptom is a question of threshold. So you don't have either energy or no energy. You have more energy or less energy. So you can hold your attention for a few minutes. How many minutes? It's a question of thresholds. Yes. And the idea is at some point you have so much that that becomes a symptom that ticks the boxes. And where you put that threshold that ticks the box is quite complicated. And it talks to what we were talking before. Because if you're going to decide how short your attention span has got to be in order to qualify as a symptom, as a disorder, then we have to revisit our old friend or idea of impairment, disability, and handicap. Yes. So at which point the level of inattention becomes a symptom of ADHD depends on where you choose to put the threshold. So if you have a brain that can only concentrate for a few, say for 1 minute, that is quite a high threshold. And that in turn will produce a disability, because if you can only concentrate for 1 minute, good luck learning to read and write and managing in school, which means that eventually you will have a handicap because you will fail in school. So it's all very good to say 1 minute is just a diverse way of concentrating, but actually if you can only concentrate for 1 minute, you end up with a handicap. So that should be a symptom, yes? Unless other things mitigate, because you might be only able to concentrate for a minute, but you might be really, really bright. So if you're really, really bright and you only concentrate for a minute, you might be able to manage. Or you might have a type of education that doesn't require you to concentrate for more than a minute. Or you might want to be a motorbike driver instead of an air traffic controller, which means you don't need to concentrate for more than a minute unless you're very excited. And therefore, the decision of where the threshold is depends on many other things. And let me give you a little bit of an example of that with kids. So let's see. Charlie here has a concentration span of about 2 minutes, is low. Yes, and Mary here has a much shorter concentration span. She can only concentrate for about 20 seconds. You know, so she's on a daze all the time. She can't concentrate. She can't pay attention to anything. So you would say she has a disorder, and he might or might not. Yes, but then whether that concentration causes a disability depends on other things, because Mary might be so bright that in 30 seconds she remembers everything, yes? Or what type of education they have, because Charlie here might go to a overcrowded class with very overworked teachers who have no time to spend with him, yes? And Mary might go to one-to-one tuition with a loving teacher who thinks she's great despite the fact that she can only focus for a few seconds and spends all the time she needs to help her learn, which means that her disability overall is less than his disability. And then there is what they want to do, because he might want to be a bike racer that doesn't need any extra concentration, but it turns out that Mary wants to be a mathematician. You know, if you can only concentrate for a few seconds, being a mathematician might be quite difficult, which means that in terms of handicap, he might not be that handicapped by only being able to concentrate for a few minutes, but she would be really handicapped trying to be a mathematician with concentration span of a few seconds. So again, where we put each of the thresholds to decide whether 2 minutes concentration or 30 seconds is a symptom depends on many other things. And that takes us to another of the controversies, because whether we decide that something is a symptom or is not a symptom does not depend only on how long they can concentrate. It depends on other things like what kind of school they go to, what they want to do when they grow up, or whether the teachers like them. I.e., it's something to do with the environment, not with their brains. Yes, and that's quite controversial. Yes, and that takes us back to what I was saying about being short-sighted and causing or not causing impairment depending on glasses, is the idea that an impairment can be mediated by glasses, but sometimes not even that. You could argue that if you're slightly short-sighted, all you need to do is move closer to the blackboard, and then you can see the blackboard perfectly, and you don't need to wear glasses. You know, just by changing the environment, you change the relationship between impairment and disability. And one could argue that is the same thing applies to kids. And what you're doing is you're medicalizing a problem which it really belongs in the environment. For instance, people who are slightly short-sighted shouldn't be expected to be able to read the blackboard from 20 meters. You know, it's the environment, is not your eyes. And the same thing applies particularly to neurodevelopmental problems, because you could argue that the problem with Charlie is not his concentration span, is his environment. And that if he only had one-to-one teaching, he might not be so disabled. Or you could argue that diagnosing him and giving him medication, what you're doing is you're making up for an education that he doesn't have. So you are medicalizing education. And you could argue the same thing for Mary. You could say, well, if she can only concentrate for 30 seconds, then she shouldn't be a mathematician. And by giving her medication, you're actually making her take a path in life that she shouldn't take. Yes, so that's where the medicalization. So do we attribute the disability to the environment, or do we attribute everything to the biology and work on the biology and ignore the environment? That's quite a controversial issue. But there's another layer of this, which is that we know that those three symptoms cause impairment and disability and handicap. Very often, kids with ADHD, their disability or their impairment comes from other symptoms, such as irritability or specific learning difficulties or temper dysregulation. Those are the ones that cause the impairment, not necessarily the impulsivity. They might have ADHD and be distractible, but actually what is causing the impairment is that they're dyslexic. Yes? And they might have ADHD as well, but and we don't have medication for dyslexia. So it is the other symptoms, it's the comorbidities. So the comorbidities means the things that are also wrong as well as ADHD. And they don't stop at neurodevelopmental problems. And of course, those affect the threshold at which the disability produced by the inattention and the hyperactivity becomes a symptom. And that's not just it. Sometimes what happens is that those symptoms, which are the product of neurodiversity or neurodevelopmental disorder, cause problems that are other. For instance, very often kids with ADHD fail to make friends because they're too impulsive, so they don't learn social skills, or they fail so much in school that they develop very low self-esteem, or because they're so difficult to parent, their relationship with their parents are damaged. And sometimes those problems are what causes the impairment and the disability. So the disability is caused by their self-esteem, not necessarily by their inattention. And this kind of secondary psychological problems are not necessarily resolved by medication, and sometimes are the problems that are presented clinically. Often they're the problems that cause the disability and the handicap. So that secondary problem, which is another controversial, difficult aspect of ADHD, that takes us to the last one, which is quite important, which is the idea that when you give a diagnosis to a kid with ADHD, you give them a label, you set them apart. So the kid with ADHD who has to take his tablets, and that in itself can affect children. We refer to that as stigma. And that's the stigma that the kids with a label, in a way, have to carry. But there's another layer of stigma in ADHD, which is the stigma of the condition. ADHD is not a label like any other. It's a label that has question marks and controversies, as I am talking at the moment. So there is a perception that ADHD is not a real condition. It's something that's been invented in order to medicalize kids or in order to let environments that shouldn't be allowed with children to continue. And in a way, it's a made-up disability that is not medical at all. And that is a view that is quite shared, is often seen in the media. And I want to spend some time just explaining why it is a condition. The first one, which is very significant, is that there is a very strong genetic association. So twin studies and adoption studies tell us that there is a huge genetic component. So these are studies up until the 90s. So 20 years ago, we already knew that the heritability, that is the percentage of the variation in a population that can be attributed to genes, is 0.7. This is higher than diabetes, for instance. And there are many image and other studies that show that the function of of kids with ADHD is different. The one that I like, that I'd like to describe a little bit today, is something called a start-stop task. And I'll explain it to you. So you get a kid and you put him in front of a screen where you show images. And then you wire the brain to functional MRI that records which bits of the brain become activated depending on what they do. And then you instruct them a task by which every time that they see a flower, they need to press a button. And you run different images, and you show images which are not a flower, one after another, until you show a flower. And when kids see a flower, what you can see is there is a part of the brain that lights up because they've recognized the flower and they intend to move, and then they press the button. And it's a pattern of activation just before movement that you can see in all kids who do this start-stop task. And the brains of kids with ADHD look exactly as the brains of kids without ADHD up to this point. But then you can change the task and say to them, you know how you've been seeing a flower and pressing the button? Well, I want you to now not press the button when you see a flower. When you see a flower, what you need to do is wait. And if the next one is a car, then you press the button. So that means that when they see a flower, they need to recognize the flower, but they also need to stop themselves pressing the button, which is what they've been doing for a couple of hours. So you show different images until you show a flower. When you show a flower, there is two things happen. First is the usual recognition of the brain that is the same for everybody. But then there is a bit of the brain that lights up, which is the bit of the brain where they stop themselves from pressing the button. And that pattern is very clear in normal individuals and very different in kids with ADHD. There is a structure in the center of the brain that lights up for non-ADHD people when they stop themselves doing something. And that doesn't show up in the functional MRI scans of ADHD kids, and this is what the picture looks like. So the structure is in the middle of the frontal lobe, and it's what's in the green box. And you can see how in normal controls, it lights up when they're shown a flower. Whilst in ADHD kids, there are other parts of the brain that pick up the slack because that bit of the brain doesn't light up. That bit of the brain is called the prefrontal cortex, is particularly the cingulate gyrus. And we know that the cingulate gyrus has a connection to the striatum, which is where movement is initiated. And we know that the connection is an inhibitory connection. It's the brake. So it is the bit that lights up when you put the brake at pressing the button. And we know that that connection is mainly a dopamine connection. There's the neurotransmitter that goes in that connection is called dopamine. Dopamine is a neurotransmitter we know very well, and we have lots of chemicals that affect it, which means that it can be treatable. That's the fourth bit of the lecture that I wanted to tell you about, which is that ADHD is an eminently treatable condition. So we were saying that the prefrontal cortex inhibits the striatum, and that that's done through dopamine, and that that seems to be weak in people with ADHD. And we have drugs that can affect that. They're called dopamine agonists. And the most commonly used one, the one we know very well, is called amphetamines. And amphetamines have been around for a long time. They were around in the 30s, where they were used as cough syrups, in the 30s and 40s, Germans realized that they helped soldiers go on for hours without sleep or eating, and the Blitzkrieg was fueled by amphetamines, as was the Battle of Britain. Most pilots during the 40s were on amphetamines when they were flying. It's a drug that's been used a lot. In the 60s and the 70s, it was used mainly to help people lose weight because it's a very appetite and sleep suppressant. And it was marketed over the counter for weight loss up until the 70s. But the drug I want to talk to you about, which is the one we use most often, is called methylphenidate. And that was invented by Leonardo Panizzon, and he designed it and tried it on his wife, who used to play tennis, and it proved his wife's tennis game so much that he named the drug after his wife, who was called Rita, and hence the name Ritalin. The drug is now off copyright, and it comes in many brands. The most used in the UK is Medikinet. It is a very effective drug. I'm going to show you two papers. This is a paper from 2018 by Cortese that compares how effective and how effective different dopamine agonists are. Methylphenidate, which is here in green, as you can see, is quite far from placebo. And the second drug that is quite remarkable is dexamphetamine and lisamphetamine, which are other amphetamines, which are there, which means they're even more effective. The problem they have is that they have more side effects, so less tolerable. The meta-analysis that shows how effective methylphenidate was published in 2015, and you can see there at the bottom how that dot is very far from the zero line, i.e. it is quite effective. It's one of the most effective drugs in psychiatry. And the way it works is absorbed quickly and then stay in blood for a while. And as long as the blood level is above certain levels, it is effective. So you would expect the drug to be effective the first hour until the 10th hour. What happens with methylphenidate is that it is only effective as long as the dose in the blood is going up, which means that methylphenidate with that curve is only effective around 4 hours. And this is a problem because that means kids need to take 3 tablets a day, and that's quite difficult. So the pharmaceutical industry have got rounded by inventing this kind of beats, where there are beats that get digested in the first minute after ingesting, and then they are mixed with other beats that take 4 hours to be digested. That means that when a kid takes a tablet, it gets the first beat gets absorbed immediately. That gives you 4 hours, and then the second beat gets absorbed after that. That gives another 4 hours. So it lasts for 8 hours, which means they take the tablet before going to school, and they come off the medication as they're coming out of school. Those capsules are usually called XL, Equisim XL or Medikinet XL. So wonderful, do they have any side effects? Well, you've already heard the main one, which is that it suppresses appetite. The appetite suppression is dose dependent. Sometimes lowering the dose means that the appetite comes back. And it's also limited in time. So kids lose their appetite only during the hours when the methylphenidate is effective. So they might skip lunch, but when it comes to dinner, they're really, really hungry. So it is manageable. But it is still important because if they chronically don't eat lunch, they end up losing weight or not gaining weight, and this might lead to growth delay, which is why any kid that goes on methylphenidate needs to have their weight monitored regularly. That's the main side effect, hands down, the one that causes more problems. The second side effect is sleep problems. So often kids with ADHD already have problems going to sleep because of their hyperactivity. And if the dose is taken a bit late, the medication itself might suppress their sleep and it might make a problem even worse. It is important to regulate when the medication is given so it doesn't interfere with sleep. And also, melatonin often helps kids with ADHD with sleep problems, and that often offsets the difficulties. Those are the two main problems, but there are two very rare problems which are severe and people need to know about, which is that kids with epilepsy or heart problems might struggle with amphetamines because amphetamines lower the epileptic threshold and raise the blood pressure slightly, which means if there are pre-existing problems, it might make them worse. Still, there are quite a few kids with epilepsy and heart problems who still take methylphenidate. And a large study conducted a few years ago showed that for kids without heart problems, methylphenidate doesn't increase mortality rates due to heart problems at all. Nonetheless, we do measure blood pressure of kids who go on medication before and afterward regularly, just like we do with weight. There are two or three other problems that are common but are a bit not so important. So often kids will have headaches for a few days or gastrointestinal problems, but these are the kind of unspecific side effects that most kids have. But every kid who goes on methylphenidate needs to have their weight measured regularly every 6 months and their blood pressure taken. So is it important to treat? Why do we need to treat? What's the prognosis? Don't they just get better by themselves? Well, some do and some don't. If you plot symptoms against age and you have a line to what constitutes a problem big enough to have a diagnosis, i.e. to cause impairment, or significant, i.e. to cause problems. What we find is that attention deficit continues to be a problem through life. It's not such a problem as it is in early childhood when concentrating in school is often a big problem. But people with attention deficit struggle with attention through their lives. What happens is they often find niches where they're either concentrating on things that they are very interested in, or they have jobs where they don't need to concentrate on things that are not interesting. So they manage their disability by doing activities where they're not handicapped. But it is a symptom that it is noticeable through life. That's not the case with hyperactivity. Hyperactivity, which is a big problem at the beginning in early school, very often by the time they're teenagers is not a problem at all. And by the time they're adults is, if anything, an asset because they have more energy than most other people. But unfortunately, that's not the case with the third symptom. Impulsivity does not reduce. What happens is as one gets older, the consequences of being impulsive become more serious. So when you are an impulsive little boy, worst thing that can happen is you might punch somebody and get expelled from school. But when you're impulsive and you have a car and you have a credit card and children, the consequences of being impulsive can be devastating. And that takes us to looking at the effects of no treatment. If you don't treat kids with ADHD, we know now because we can follow them that there is a much higher rate of educational failure and social problems and self-confidence and secondary psychological problems. There is also a much increased rate of accidents. So kids with ADHD get run over because they're impulsive and they take risks. And one of the risks they do when they're older is they're more likely to try drugs and they're more likely to get addicted to drugs because a lot of them are very stimulating and that goes very well with their problems. So they end up having double the rate of addictions than kids without ADHD. Funny enough, when they get treated, the rate of addictions goes back to baseline normal population. There is quite a few other mental health problems associated with ADHD, borderline personality disorder in women, but many other problems, including conduct problems, behavioral difficulties. So treatment has its problems, but not treatment has its problems as well. That's all I want to say about treatment. That's the fourth of the four things I wanted to tell you today. I'll remind you quickly. I said that ADHD is a neurodevelopmental disorder, and we looked at neurodiversity and what constitutes a neurological disorder. And you remember we talked about impairment that might or might not lead to disability, who might or might not lead to a handicap. Then we talked about the symptoms themselves, and we said that it's to do with attention, sustaining attention, and the energy and impulsivity, which is the lack of breaks. And then we talked a little bit about the controversies, and we talked about how difficult it is to find the threshold at which deficit becomes a symptom or an impairment becomes a disability, particularly in things like sustaining attention or being impulsive, which all children are. We talked that it is controversial because a lot of the disability can be avoided by changing the environment, and sometimes we choose drugs instead of changing the environment, and therefore we medicalize things. We talked about the comorbidities that sometimes are bigger problems than the symptoms themselves, and the secondary problems in terms of social skills and self-esteem and attachment. And we talked a little bit about stigma, both to the child that is set apart by having a diagnosis, but also the stigma to do with the condition. And we talked that it is a neurological observable condition, and it is genetically associated. And the last bit, which was the idea that it is treatable. I told you that some symptoms go away, but things like impulsivity don't go away, that the treatment's been around for many years, and that is readily available, that the tablets work for about 8 hours, but they have side effects, and therefore we need to monitor weight and blood pressure because they cause poor appetite and sleep problems. That's the last bit I'm going to say, the treatability, and those are the four things I wanted you to know about ADHD. My name is Carlos Hoyos, and you can contact me through my email. Thank you very much.